How's everybody doing? Good, y'all look good. Glad to be back here with you, amen. We had a wonderful trip, and thank you guys so much for the break and everything, and it was just a blessing. And do I look refreshed? Good, I feel refreshed, yeah. So anyway, we're glad to be back. Survived the plane ride, so thank you for that. I still don't understand turbulence. I don't know what the plane is bumping into in the middle of the air. I did happen to gain 3 pounds on the trip, but I managed to get it all back off by today. So praise the Lord for that. And so, you know, I've never seen a place like Grandma's house. They're like, hey, here's breakfast. Here's brunch. Here's lunch. Here's an afternoon snack. Here's dinner. Here's a midnight buffet. Times seven. And so anyway, praise God. I miss you guys. I miss this place right here. It's good to be. It's good to see you. There's no place like home, and there's no place like White Ash. Amen? All right. So, my man Darren, he brought me a tithing envelope. He said, here, I want to give this to you when he came in. I thought it was a joke, but it was funny. We're going to do trivia. That'd be okay? All right. Come on in, Ryan. We're going to do trivia. Now, you need to declare a team. Which team are you on? Okay. All right. Okay. All right. Who won last week? Have you guys won yet? 3-0. Skunkins. All right. Here we go. I'll start with you guys tonight. I'll start with this side. Well, that's true, because if you guys notice, every week that Dave preaches, he always has me come up and do the prayer request. And the reason why he does that is because he can't hear y'all. And so it's not that he can't take prayer requests, he just can't hear. I'll be there one of these days, Dave. Yeah. All right. All right, question one for the east side. What did the Israelites throw on their heads as a sign of sorrow? Richard Jones. Ashes. Ashes is correct, Richard. Very good. All right. West Side. According to 2 Chronicles, so that's after 1 Chronicles. Yeah. What is the significance of Mount Moriah? What is the significance of Mount Moriah? Going once, going twice. Anybody, anybody? It was the place where they were going to build the second temple, or the temple, excuse me, Solomon's temple. Yeah, yeah. Okay. 1-0. You guys got him up tonight. Got him against the ropes. Can you take another big swing here? Who will be the first two thrown in the lake of fire as recorded by John in the book of Revelation? Who will be the first two thrown in the lake of fire? Hi, Addie. I'll give you that. The beast and the false prophet. The beast is the Antichrist. So, yep. Very good. 2-0. All right. Which book in the Bible immediately precedes Hebrews? You want to talk with your crew?
I'm guessing I'm wrong.
No, I just want to, you know, I don't just, that's what Dave got into last night. Last week, he heard an answer and spit it out.
Is it James? Am I right on that? James.
Okay, yes.
No.
No? Ah.
It's Philemon, yeah. Hebrews, James, yeah. That's the book afterwards, yeah. What name did Jesus give to James and John, which means sons of thunder? Do you know it? I'll give you an opportunity in just a second if you know it, yeah. I'm not going to let him stake the point, but I'll let him relax. It's okay. Hey, Eastside, get control of her. Gloria, come up behind her. Sit behind her. What name did Jesus give to James and John, which means sons of thunder? Three, two, one. Sons of Zebedee's incorrect. Boanerges. Boanerges. Mark 3:17. Mark 3:17 in the King James. Because I looked it up here and it wasn't NLT, but in the King James, it's Mark 3:17. Boanerges. Boanerges. And I may not be saying that correct. Boanerges. Boanerges. And I even looked it up on Google to find out how to pronounce it. Boanerges. That means sons of thunder. Yeah. Yeah. All right. You guys have lost. But I'll give you your last question. I got two questions left. Oh, because there's seven questions. All right. I'm going to give you one I know you can get. Recite Psalm 23, verse 5. Now, y'all, thou preparest. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Thou head with oil. My cup runneth over. Very good. Very good. Amen. That's verse 6. Yeah. 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 We stopped there. Amen. All right. Well, we're going to go to the Lord in prayer. It is good to be back in the house of the Lord. Amen. All right. Heavenly Father, thank you, thank you, thank you, God, for letting us come back here tonight. Thank you for the privilege and honor it is to serve such a great and awesome and a mighty God. We thank you for the richness of life. We thank you for a place to worship. We thank you for the mighty Word of God. And tonight, Lord, as we sing unto you, may our voices be a sweet sound to your ear. I pray you'd anoint our time of worship. I pray you'd anoint the Word tonight. Speak to us. Give us what we stand in need of tonight. May it be a refresher for us on this Wednesday evening. And God, I just pray your Holy Spirit fall upon us tonight. In Jesus' name, and we all said, amen.
Please stand with me if you can to go give God praise tonight.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory. Shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You laid down your us, I sing for all that you've done for me. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Yes, Lord God, we just thank you and we praise you for your amazing grace, Lord God.
I searched the world, but it couldn't fill me. Man's empty praise and treasures that fade are never enough. Then you came along and put me back together. Now satisfied here in your love. Oh, there's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you. I'm not afraid to show you my weakness, my failures and flaws. Lord, you've seen them all, and you still call me friend. 'Cause the God of the mountain is the God of the valley. There's not a place your mercy and grace won't find me again. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you. There's nothing better than You turn mourning to dancing. You give beauty for ashes. You turn shame into glory. You're the only one who can. You turn graves into gardens. You turn bones into armies. You turn seas into highways. You're the only one who can. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing. Nothing is better than you. You turn mourning to dancing. You give beauty for ashes. You turn shame into glory. You're the only one who can. You turn graves into gardens. You turn bones into armies. You turn seas into highways. You're the only one who can. You're the only one who can. You're the only one who can. Not skilled to understand what God has willed, what God has planned. I only know at his right hand stands one who is my Savior. I take him at his word and deed. Christ died to save me, this I read. And in my heart I find a need of him to be my Savior. That he would leave his place on high and come for simple men to die. You count it strange, so did I, before I knew my Savior. My Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God, he was, my God, he is, my God is always gonna be. My Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God, he was, my God, he is, my God is. Living, dying, let me bring my strength, my solace from this spring. That he who lives to be my king once died to be my Savior. He will leave his place on high and come for simple man to die. You count it strange, so once did I, before I knew my Savior. My Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God, He was, my God, He is, my God is always gonna be. My Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God, He was, my God, He is, my God is always gonna be. My Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God, He was, my God, He is, my God is always gonna be. My Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God, He was, my God, He is, my God is always gonna be. An awesome God here. awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God.
Lord God, you are so awesome, Lord Jesus. Words cannot describe how amazing you are, Lord Jesus. We thank you for your amazing grace, Lord God. May we never stop worshiping. May we never forget the sacrifice that you made for us, Lord God. We just love you, and we give you all the glory and honor and praise tonight. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen, 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 amen. If you have your Bibles, you can open up to Exodus chapter 20. And that's where we're going to be for the next 10 weeks. We're going to start tonight looking at the 10 commandments. And so I'll do commandment 1. Dave, do 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. We'll switch off every week. And so I know that we all probably know the 10 commandments, but do we really know what they're expecting of or demanding from our lives? First thing I'd like for you to know tonight is that not only the Ten Commandments will not save you, because the truth is we can't keep them. We've all broke them. Our salvation comes through who? Jesus Christ and Christ alone. But I will tell you that following the Ten Commandments, the moral law, will help you live a much better life here on earth. Can I get an amen? And so Tim Keller, former pastor, said, idolatry is the sin beneath every other sin. Idolatry is the sin beneath every other sin. And so when I sin, when you sin, what we're basically saying is we're allowing something to take God's place in our life. And so every time we sin, we're allowing something to take God's place in our life. And so tonight, as we look at the first commandment, it is have no other gods before me. King James says it like this: you shall have no other gods before me. Before I get too far into the Ten Commandments, I just want to summarize them for you real fast. The first four are what we call vertical commandments. They have to do between us and God. They go like this: you shall have no other gods before me. The second commandment is you should have no graven images. The third command is you shall not take the Lord's name in vain. And the fourth command is you shall remember the Sabbath and keep it holy. Jesus summarized these vertical commandments when he was asked by the Pharisees, what is the greatest commandment? And Jesus replied, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. Second, the last six commandments are horizontal commandments. They're between how we treat others. The first one is commandment number 5, honor thy mother and father. Commandment number 6, thou shalt not kill. Commandment number 7, thou shalt not commit adultery. Commandment number 8, thou shalt not steal. Commandment number 9, thou shalt not lie. Commandment number 10, thou shalt not be jealous, or thou shalt not covet. And Jesus said, sum these up in one verse, when he said, what is the second greatest commandment? Is loving your neighbor as yourself. And so we summarize, we see that Jesus did not take away the Ten Commandments, but he established them, or really even reduced them down to those two statements. And so tonight as we look, I want us to look at these, at the very first commandment, you shall have no other gods before me. It's found in Exodus chapter 20. We're going to read verses 1 through 3. It says, then God gave the people all these instructions. He says, I am the Lord your God, who rescued you from the land of Egypt and the place of your slavery. You must not have any other gods, any other God but me. And so, over the course of my pastorate here at White Ash, I've done 107 weddings. And so I did not record the number of funerals. I'm certain that I've done a whole lot more funerals than I have weddings. But I was able to go back and just start writing down, not just at White Ash, but from the time that I answered the call to the ministry. And so this year I'm scheduled to do my son's and Krista's in late August, and it'll be 108 in the collection. I'm going to do Ty Avery's wedding in Whitney's in October. That'll be 109. And I think it's kind of cool to keep up with. When I first started doing weddings, the first couple that I did ended in divorce pretty fairly quickly. And I thought, well, I can't keep this track record up. And so I started meeting with couples and counseling with them before they got married, because really, most of the time, young couples are infatuated with what's going on in their life, right? And when you meet somebody and you have those stars in your eyes and those feelings, you just want to live together and form a house, and it's so exciting, and et cetera, et cetera. And you kind of really miss what you're committing to. And so now I take anywhere from 4 to 6 weeks meeting with couples and just sharing with them, hey, here's the problems you'll run into. They won't always be as pretty as they are right now. It may not always be as exciting as it is right now, but ultimately you're making a commitment to one another. You're asking them to esteem or to build you up, to respect or admire, to enter this relationship with you above anything else in your life. And so when we, really what we ask them is we say, hey, will you esteem your husband, will you esteem your wife more than anybody else in your life? And so most of the time in my office, before they ever get married, they say, yes, absolutely, without a shadow of a doubt, I will esteem my spouse above anything. But then ultimately, the hard times come. Amen? And eventually, different things happen. Really, when we talk about this first commandment, really a word that we should use is esteem. That we would esteem God above all other things in our life, above all other people in our life. The first thing I want to point out to you tonight is found in verse 2. In verse 2, we see four reasons to not have any other gods before him. Let's read verse 2 together. It says, I am the Lord your God who rescued you from the land of Egypt and the place of your slavery. Let's start off with, I am the Lord. I am the Lord. In other words, he is creator. The Bible tells us in Colossians chapter 1, verse 15 and 16, it says, Christ is the visible image of the invisible God. He existed before everything was created and is supreme over all creation. For through him, God created everything in the heavenly realms and on earth. He made the things that we can see and the things that we can't see, such as thrones and kingdoms, rulers and authorities in the unseen world. Everything was created through him and by him and for him. Psalm 103 says this. It says, acknowledge that the Lord is God. He made us and we are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. I wasn't really prepared this past week. A lot of people said Alaska is going to be beautiful and you're never going to see anything like it. And I'm just like, yeah, okay. You know, have you seen Southern Illinois? Amen? Because frankly, I think Southern Illinois is beautiful. It's my home place. It always has been my home place. I love spring. I love fall. But to be honest with you, words do not do justice to what I was able to see this past week. Literally, I never really rendered speechless, but when we got into this place called Glacier Bay, Alaska, I really don't think there are words that can adequately describe what you're able to see. And you had these thousands of year old glaciers, and you had these mountains, and these glaciers were 20 miles long and a mile wide, and they went about 7,000 or 8,000 feet up in the air, and you were covered by this crystal blue water that formed from the ice. And the glaciers themselves, they didn't just appear white, but they appeared this certain color blue because the sun was radiating on it. In this past week in Alaska, the people who were there and even the tour guide said it was the prettiest week they'd seen in Alaska in a long time. Usually it rains there this time of year majority of the time. Every day was crystal clear blue skies. And when we were standing there, when we pulled into this park, we'd seen a lot of Alaska, and it was all breathtaking. But when we pulled in there, I was like, wow. And you sat there on your balcony, and words could not describe, but you finally understood, I think, what the songwriter wrote when he wrote these words. Oh Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I seen the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. But then there's that second verse that we often leave out. When through the woods and forest glades I wander and hear the birds sing sweetly in the trees, in this part right here, when I look down from lofty mountain grandeur and hear the brook and feel the gentle breeze, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art. And when you look and see this second verse, I am the Lord. Not only did I create all things, but I created you. I formed you in my image with my own hands. I breathed air into your lungs. And were it not for God, we do not exist. And the creation is always expected, or always should. It should be demanded that we worship the Creator. And so why should we esteem God? Why should we honor this first commandment? Because He is our Creator. Secondly, not only is He our Creator, He's our covenant maker. I am the Lord your God. Look what it says. It's not somebody else's God, your God. He wants a relationship with who? With you. The Bible says that He came from heaven to earth. It tells us this in Romans chapter 5, verse 8. But God demonstrated His love towards us while we were yet sinners. Christ still died for us. And I want you to know tonight that not only is your Creator, but your Creator wants a relationship with you. It's a possessive term, not somebody else's God, but your God. And He declares this, I am the Lord your God. I created you. I created this earth. I created all things. Why should you have no other gods before me? Because I am your God. And so not only do we see that He is the Creator and that He is this covenant maker, He creates these covenants that we enter into, these relationships that we enter into. Reason three, as it continues in verse 2, He says, I have who rescued you from the land of Egypt and the place of your slavery. He's not only just our Creator, He's not only our covenant maker, but here it says He's our Redeemer. The Bible tells us in Colossians chapter 1, verse 13 and 14, it says, for He rescued us from the kingdom of darkness and transferred us unto the kingdom of His dear Son, who purchased our freedom and forgave our sins. Ex algarzo is the Greek word, to be bought from the marketplace, to be purchased from, to be delivered from. We think of Hosea when he went and bought his prostitute wife from the marketplace. Not deservingly, but he paid the purchase for her. I heard this story about this young boy, and he had built this sailboat. He had ordered it, and he had to build certain parts of it, and he put it all together, and he painted it, and he glued it together, and he created all the sails, and he finally got it together, this model sailboat, and it was just a beautiful sight. He was proud of what he created. And so the day came when he took it out to the local lake, and as he took it out to the local lake, he sets it, and he wants to sell it. He wants to see it go, see if it'll float, and he sets it down at the edge of the lake, and it begins to go out into the lake just a little bit, and before long, this big gust of wind came, and it took the boat where he could no longer see it, and he started running the shoreline to the right, to the left, looking for his boat, and devastated, he never could find his boat. About 2 weeks later, he was walking through the town and he passed a pawn shop. In the window of his pawn shop, in the window of the pawn shop was that red sailboat that he had built. It was unmistakable. It had his initials on it. He could see the boat. He could see the sails. He goes in and he looks at the pawn shop owner. He says, "That's my boat." And he tells him the story, and the pawn shop owner looks at him. He says, "Hey, I don't know anything about that. I know that I paid $14 for that boat. And if you want that boat, it's going to cost you $14. The boy didn't have the $14. He goes home. He starts looking through his piggy bank, and he gathers all the change and all that he can find. And finally, he comes up with the $14. He brings it back to the pawn shop. He sets it all down, and he looks at the pawn shop owner, and he says, "I want to buy my boat." He pays the $14. That man gives him the boat. The boy walks out, and he clutches the boat type to his chest, and he said, "I've got you twice. I said, I've owned you twice now." He says, "The first time I created you, and the second time I bought you." And isn't the same with God? He created us and he purchased us through the blood of his son, Jesus Christ. Why should we have no other gods before him? Because he is our creator, because he's our covenant maker, because he's our redeemer. And the fourth reason is because he's our rewarder. Look down in verse 12. When we start looking at this, we see that verse 12 literally links to the first commandment given unto man, but it collects those first five. It says, "Honor thy father and mother, then you will live a long, full life in the land the Lord your God is giving you." In other words, he says, you're going to a place. You're going to a place where I have created you. We see that not only does God want to have a relationship with us because he created us, because he redeemed us, but he also is a rewarder of things in our life. All good things that you have on this earth come from God and God alone. The promises which God has for every person who has come to a knowing relationship in him, a place of eternal life, God is the rewarder of us. So why should we have no other gods before him? Because he's our creator, because he's our covenant maker, because he is our redeemer, because he's our rewarder. But we have to look at verse 3. Really, what does it mean to have no other gods before him? Look what the verse says. It says in verse 3, "You must not have any other gods but me." NLT, King James says, "You shall have." You shall have. What does that word "shall have"? Shall have means to possess. It means to own something, to have something. When I'm meeting with those couples before marriage, I go over their vows. I ask them, and many of you I've married, and you'll know that I have had you say this. I'll look at the husband and I'll say, "Do you take so-and-so, the wife, to be your lawfully wedded wife, to have and to hold from this day forward, for better, for worse, for richer, for poorer, in sickness and in health, till death do you part, for the good that may lighten your days and the bad that may darken your days, till death alone shall part you." And ultimately we hear the "I do." What does it mean to have? To have means to possess. They become yours. I have a truck outside. It's my truck. If somebody went and got in my truck and drove off, I wouldn't allow that to happen. I have a house. I recently purchased my parents' house. I have a house. I have a deed. I have a mortgage payment, and I don't let anybody just walk around my house. It's my house. At home, I have my wife. And listen, her affection is mine. Nobody else can own it. It's mine. She gave it to me, and likewise, mine hers. She's my wife. And so here, when we look at this, God is saying, "You're mine. I possess you. I'm going to let God possess my life. You shall have no other gods before me." So we see the "shall have." Secondly, we see the "no other gods before me." The Israelites had spent 430 years in slavery. 430 years. That's like twice the amount of age of Frank. That's a long time. America's not even 430 years old. When you think of the amount of time they spent in slavery, during that time, we see that they were familiarized with a lot of Egyptian gods. And you notice that Israel, they never abandoned the Lord their God. They just became accustomed to the gods of their culture. And they started adding their practices and their worships to God himself. But that's not what God asked for. He says, "You shall have no other gods before me." He doesn't want to be added to. When we look at the picture of culture and all the things that try to become our gods, whether it be keeping up with our money or our jobs or sports or kids or whatever else becomes the apple of our eye, we really realize that we've created these small mini gods that go after our respect, that go after our admiration, that we esteem. But really, how do we ask? How do we actually ask that we, how do we know if we have other gods before Him? I was reading this book this past week called Laws That Liberate. It's by Bill Hybels. Anybody ever heard of Bill Hybels? But anyway, in the book, he gives us three questions to answer when we look at about how we know if we're honoring any other gods before Him. I'm going to read these three questions to you tonight and expound on them. They're good to write down. Number one, how do you know if you're esteeming and living for God alone? Question number one, what do you think about the most often? Where do your thoughts naturally turn to? When you finally lay yourself down to sleep, when you shut off everything in the world, where do your thoughts turn to? Because typically what you think about and what you dwell on the most will ultimately become your God. Have you ever taken a compass and you shake the compass up? And for a moment, it might point to a different direction through all the chaos. But after just a few moments, it always returns to what? To true north. And when you settle down, when you settle down and get all the chaos out of your ears and out of everything else, and you look and you say, what is my true north? And if your true north doesn't turn back to God, what other gods do you have in your life? Where do your thoughts naturally wander? Secondly, not only do we have to ask the question, what do we think about the most often? Secondly, we have to ask the question, who are you trying to impress? Is it a friend? Is it associate? Is it culture? I think about all the things that we try to impress and what we get back. We were sitting at the dinner table this week with meeting different people, and we were on this cruise with a guy by the name of Dr. Robert Jeffers, who is the pastor of First Baptist Dallas. And he's one of the guys that I kind of listen to. I listen to his podcast every day and have for years. When I would go back and forth to see Scott and Tanya when they lived in Texas, Scott would always take me down to First Baptist Dallas, and I just loved hearing him preach. He's a little small guy, and he has kind of a funny voice. I always thought he had a toupee. Found out this week he didn't. And so he was talking about followers, how many followers he has on certain social medias. This past week when we were there, he spoke out that former President Trump had retweeted one of his statements. And I thought to myself, really, when we look at our social media culture that we live in, we have all these influencers, and these influencers want to get followers and they want to get likes. See, there's a powerful thing that happens when you post something. Somebody will like it. If you don't know Facebook or Instagram, they'll like it. They can give it a heart, a care symbol. They can even, if they disagree with it, they can give it an angry face. They can give it a wow face or a sad face. In other words, they're implying that, hey, we saw what you posted and we recognized it. It makes people feel good. The scientists say that it gives a certain inducement of hormones even when somebody likes one of your posts. And the goal when you look at social media is, how many followers can I get and how many likes or reactions can I get to a certain post? We air and broadcast our services every Sunday and every Wednesday on Facebook. And the next day after the Facebook will always send me a report to my email and tell me how many reactions and how many times people clicked on the video. And do I want to do more? Do I want to do less? How many people looked at it? 3 seconds, 3 minutes, that they watched it longer than 10 minutes or whatever the case. It's amazing what they know and the insights that they have. And people long for these likes and these hearts. And some of you in this room, you know what I'm talking about. It feels good to get them. And then some people even go further. They ask themselves, well, why didn't so-and-so like my post? Why didn't so-and-so look at my post? Why didn't so-and-so do this or do that? And when we think about Jesus Christ, really, He gave us the biggest like symbol of all time. He died on the cross for us. He gave you the biggest heart symbol that you could ever have. He gave you the biggest validation that you could ever have in your life. And when He looks at this, have no other gods before me.
Ask yourself who you're trying to impress. The men, the church fathers of the old had this saying, Coram Deo. How many of you ever heard it? Coram Deo means before the eyes of God. Before the eyes of God. And the question is, are you living your life, Coram Deo, before the eyes of God? Because whether you know it or believe it or not, you have an audience of one. Because at the end of the day, your social media followers won't last. Your friends, you may have a million, but that won't last. But the only thing that will last is God Almighty. You will not stand before the throne of culture. You will stand before the throne of God. So we ask ourselves this question, who are you trying to impress? And if the answer is not God, then you have other gods before you. The third and final question, what do you think about most often? Who are you trying to impress? And last but certainly not least, what are you living for? I remember during the summertime when I was a young man, I would go to my Grandma Dorothy's house. And Grandma Dorothy, me and my cousin Benjamin, we would hang out there all day. We would get there early in the morning. Our parents would drop us off before work. We'd have our biscuits and gravy. We'd watch a few cartoons to start the morning, and then we'd take off. Grandma didn't want us in the house. We'd have to ride bikes or play with the neighbors. We'd go down to Washington School. Whatever we could do or get into. On the good days, Granddaddy would take us fishing or somewhere. We'd go riding with him, depending on where he was going, depending on whether we wanted to go or not, because he could talk for a long time. Might be gone for hours at a time. And so anyway, nonetheless, we would have these days. And I could always remember coming in around lunchtime because Grandma would always have a lunch made. And so we go in. Typically, it was either lunch meat or some type of leftovers. And I could always hear her say she'd get it out and she'd tell us to go eat. And she'd go into the living room and there was this show that always played called One Life to Live. I never watched it. Don't know much about it. But I know them old women love their stories. But I thought about, Gloria said, not me. But I thought about just the title. Because there's a lot of truth in the title. How many lives do we have? One. We have one life to live. And this commandment begs the question, who are you living for? Who are you living for? What is your ultimate goal in life? Really, it's to discover God's will and to do it. One person said it like this, there's two principles to live by. There's two principles in life. Everything boils down to these two principles. You're either going to follow one or the other. The first one is, one has me at the center of the universe, and the other has God at the center of the universe. One of those principles are the marching orders of your life. How do we live our life for God? We discover God's will for our life, and we do it. And so when we look at this commandment, and we look at all that it says, you must have, I am the Lord your God. I am your, I'm yours. I'm your creator, your covenant maker, your redeemer. I'm your rewarder. You shall have no other gods before me. And you'll find out real quick what other gods are before him. When you look at where your thoughts end up, when you find out who you're trying to impress, you find out what you're living for. Amen. Heavenly Father, we are thankful for your word tonight. Thankful for this commandment of God. Lord, may each of us have you and you alone in our life. May we recognize you as creator and covenant maker, redeemer and rewarder. May we realize that there shall be no other gods before you. God, we thank you for our time together. In Jesus' name we pray, and we all said, amen. Amen. We're going to take prayer requests. I have a few here that I will give to you. I left an earlier prayer chain that it did not. I don't think that it went out because I was looking when I left the last one and I noticed that it didn't go out. I want to give you an update first on Sister Belinda Smith. She did not have a blood clot. They did find an unusual nodule in her lung, and they're going to have future testing for that. And so if you will continue to remember Belinda in your prayers and pray God's touch upon her. Secondly, we want to continue to remember Malia Bowles. Do you have an update that you can give us today, Amy? I know you've been in contact with him quite a bit. Okay. So we want to continue to remember Malia, and we're just praying for some results that they can handle or just heal her completely. Amen. Aubrey Antrim, which is a 16-year-old cousin of Don Hancock, is having her colon removed at Children's Hospital tomorrow. And so if you can remember her, again, her name is Aubrey Antrim. Aubrey Antrim in your prayers. I put out earlier on the prayer chain Norma, which is Louise's friend, battling bone cancer. And so if you could, please remember her in your prayers. Had a few others. Let's see. Janet Fox. Janet had to go to the emergency room earlier yesterday due to heat exposure. They had to give her IVs and fluids. So if you could, please remember her in your prayers. Remember Richie and Lisa Vick's grandson, Reese. He's still in the NICU. We'll be there a few more days. Their daughter-in-law got to come home, so we praise the Lord for that. We also want to continue to remember both Richie and Lisa in our prayers, the health issues, Richie's heart, and Lisa as well. And so if you want to just continue to lift those prayers, lift that family up in your prayers, I know they will appreciate it. Remember my wife, Stephanie. We got off the plane Sunday at 1 a.m., and she got a stuffy nose, and she said, oh, we've gone from 50-degree weather to 100-degree weather. And then on Monday, we found out that she had COVID. So if you see me bumping you tonight, that's why. I'm not hugging. And she's doing better. I really think it was a ploy to have me do all the laundry and grocery shopping, which I did as a good husband without complaining whatsoever. But I'm glad that I don't do laundry on a regular basis, because she would not... my clothes were fine. I did them all in one load. Her clothes, she only washes three items because they're delicate, you know. And anyway, nonetheless, please pray that Steph will get to feel better. In fact, she's watching us. Everybody turn around and say, hey, Stephanie, because she misses her church. I know she does. What other prayer requests do we have tonight? Judy McRoy, you guys just said you just came from her funeral earlier. Charlie? So you said Michael Ward, Zach Johnson, and also Rusty Ward? Rusty Ward family, okay. Absolutely. John Tanner? Alan, getting ready to have a heart cath. Martha, did you have your hand raised? Yes, remember Tim, he was recently diagnosed with prostate cancer. Has he been to Alaska? You know, I told Stephanie, I never wanted to go on a cruise. I said, every time I said, I see people go on cruises, they come back, they got COVID, the sewers back up, something. And we got there the other day, and she said, see, we didn't get pirated, the sewers didn't back up. And then we got home, and I said... We will continue to pray, though. Ed? That's who I called out at the beginning. Yeah, Louise's friend, Norma. Yeah, battling bone cancer. Sure did. Yeah, she was the third, fourth one on my list here. Yep. Remember Wyatt Reed, his cancer is back. Mel? Remember the floods in Minnesota. Absolutely. I said, remember the floods of Minnesota. Amen. Susie? Dana and Jack. Victor. She broke more than a few bones, my friend. We will definitely be praying for Angie Howe. Somebody talked over here? Keith? Josh and Larissa? Health problems. Okay. Amen. And he just got done climbing a mountain. Carson did, didn't he? How high did they go?
Their goal was 14,000, and they made it 13,000.
This aorta sounds fine to me. Yeah, exactly. So, praise God. Amen. Gloria, you had your hand up? Remember Jim Danilevich. Oh, yeah, I'm glad you said Dave. Remember Dave, he's got an infected foot. I think he's got two treatments left to go. And so remember him. Rachel. Yeah. God likes to work when nothing else will. Marcel? Okay, I'm sorry, keep going. That's on Sunday night she's going in?
Sunday day.
Okay. Sunday day. Where are they doing that at? Nashville. Okay. So remember that, because we've really been praying for results, and also pray that God works through it. Amen. Remember Anna. Marcel? Dale and Barb Malone and Jeannie Hanks. Shirley? Vicky. Man. All right. Martha Pelhank asked that we would pray for Brother Mike Ebert and his family. He pastored First Church of God in Marion for over 10 years, and his wife, Jean, passed away. So remember the Ebert family. All righty. If you all want to, we'll approach the altar and we'll pray out up here. God is good. All the time. Feels good to be back in the house of the Lord tonight. So, I can. Mr. Delay. Scans on Wednesday. So, we're praying for good results for those scans. Amen. All right. Well, Heavenly Father, we are so thankful to be back in the house of God tonight. Thankful, Lord, for each person here. And God, as we just do as you commanded us to in the book of Hebrews, that we could boldly approach the throne of grace to ask for help and mercy in our time of need. Lord, we extend these prayer requests to your throne tonight. You know the situations and you know the circumstances. You know the diseases that people are battling. You know the pressures that they're facing. You know, God, the things that are working and the thoughts of their mind. And Lord, tonight, we just pray your will be done in each and every one of these situations. God, we ultimately pray for healing. But Lord, more than anything, we pray for the spiritual healing of those who are battling these things. I pray, dear God, tonight, if they do not know you as their personal Savior, that their circumstance or their whatever they're facing, God might lead them to a closer relationship with you where they might surrender their hearts and minds to you and you alone. God, we know, Lord, that these lives will not last forever, but we know that eternity will. And we know, God, that you are the only way, you're the only direction. So tonight, we pray, dear God, Lord, for spiritual healing for each one of the people who stand in need of it. We pray for those lost loved ones, those unsaved ones, those co-workers and children and grandchildren, those on our heart. God, those who in this room are calling out every night on behalf of their kids and their grandkids and their neighbors and their friends and their co-workers, God, that they might surrender their hearts and minds and lives unto Thee. And so, Lord, tonight we just ask, dear God, that You work only as You can. I pray that we would see the fruit and hear the testimony thereof. God, that we might see them come to a knowing relationship in You. God, I pray for those who are facing cancer and all the things that they're struggling with. We just pray for your healing hand upon them. We pray, dear God, that you would touch their bodies and ease their pain. We pray, dear God, for those who are grieving the loss of loved ones. We pray, God, that you would speak peace unto them. And Lord, your word tells us that you're a very present help in time of trouble. Lord, we give you praise, God, for the reports of Heather tonight. We praise you for that. Lord, that's we sought you and we heard you and we thank you for that. Lord, we thank you for the new baby that was born this week, for Logan and Morgan that we prayed, God, right here at this altar, Lord, that they might have a child. And we see that your results. You're a miracle worker and we give you praise and honor for that. Thank you so much for being such a great and awesome and a mighty God. I pray that you be with each of us as we leave here tonight. Lord, may we go and be distributors of your word. May we, Lord, honor that commandment that you gave us, that we would have no other gods before you, that you would be the center place of our life, that we would live to impress an audience of one, you alone. We give you all the praise, all the honor, and all the glory, and we agree together tonight and said, amen. Amen. Good to see everybody. Don't forget, we've got church on Sunday. Amen.